The preliminary hearing for a hate attack case against a Filipino family in North Carolina begins. Steve Angeles reports.
The preliminary hearing for the May 2022 anti-Asian hate attack on a Filipino-American family in North Hollywood began on Tuesday. First called to testify was Patricia Roque, who was in the passenger seat of their vehicle at a fast food parking lot. When the accused, Nicholas Weber, rear-ended them before making anti-Asian comments and physically confronting Patricia's parents, Gabriel and Narissa. She addressed a crowd of about 100 supporters before entering the courthouse.
At the end of the day, my family and I just want justice for what happened to us. We don't have any ulterior motives. We don't have any agenda to promote. We just want to show how community is very vital in support, and when it comes to facing injustice.
During Patricia's testimony, the prosecutor and the defense team asked her to recount the incident, as they played some video taken from Patricia's phone, as well as a recording from police officers after the incident. Throughout the day, community members filled the courtroom, the hallway, and the plaza of the Van Nuys courthouse.
The process is definitely not easy. It is a long way to the justice that we want to see, right? And so we really ask for the community members to continue supporting the family, and because what we're fighting for is righteous.
Weber appeared in court dressed in a blue prison suit, seated next to his public defender. He faces two felony battery counts, both with hate crime enhancements. Other members of the Roque family are expected to testify during the continuation of the proceedings this week. The judge will then decide if the case moves to a jury trial. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Van Nuys, California.
China and imposed sanctions on a Taiwanese diplomat as well as two American organizations over the U.S. visit of Taiwanese President Tsai Ing-wen. It barred think tank Hudson Institute and the Reagan Library in California from conducting any exchanges or transactions with Chinese entities and individuals. These organizations had hosted Tsai during her stopovers from visits to Central Africa. China also imposed further sanctions on Shao Bikim, Taiwan's ambassador to the U.S. Measures include prohibiting her and her family members from entering the mainland, Hong Kong, and Macau. Xiao reacted to her latest sanctions on Twitter, as she was previously sanctioned in August following the visit of then-U.S. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi to Taiwan. A Chinese military ship was seen moving in waters close to Taiwan as Beijing begins 3 days of military drills around the island nation. The ship fired a round from its deck as it sailed around Pingtan Island, China's closest point to Taiwan. The self-ruled island, meanwhile, says there are already 13 Chinese aircraft and 3 warships around Taiwan. In response, Taiwan's defense ministry said it would respond calmly, rationally, and with a serious attitude.
We showed the international community that in the face of pressure and threats, Taiwan will be even more united and will absolutely not yield to suppression and stop exchanges with the world.
Beijing earlier announced it will conduct drills from April 8 to 10. This is in response to Taiwanese President Tsai's meeting with U.S. House Speaker McCarthy in California. China views the self-ruled island as its own territory and has not ruled out the use of force to bring the island under its control. Chinese President Xi Jinping and French President Emmanuel Macron discuss trade and the Ukraine war as they meet in Guangzhou City. Xi told Macron France is welcome to continue to participate in China's trade expos to further expand the Chinese market for its enterprises. Macron meanwhile said France is ready to work with China with mutual respect to sovereignty and territorial integrity. They also discussed the war in Ukraine, with Xi saying a political solution is the only way out of the conflict. He added France is welcome to bring up a specific plan for resolving the crisis through political solutions, noting that China is willing to support and play constructive roles in the process. Another underwater attack drone test from North Korea. State media reported it launched another kind of nuclear-capable unmanned attack weapon called Hae-il-2 on Saturday. Now, this comes just over a week after it disclosed a new underwater drone system dubbed Hae-il-1. The name translates to tsunami in Korean. North Korea has ramped up its military activities in recent weeks in protest of the joint military exercises of the U.S. and South Korea. Russia has formally charged the Wall Street Journal reporter Ivan Gershkovich with spying. Gershkovich, a U.S. citizen, was arrested last week. Russian officials insist he was caught red-handed, but the case has been classified as secret, limiting the amount of information available. The Wall Street Journal called the charges against Gershkovich categorically false and unjustified. As fighting rages on in Ukraine's Bakhmut city, volunteer fighters only have one dream: to win the war and go home to their families as soon as possible. At this report.
Their task is to disembark from the armored personnel vehicle as quickly as possible and take combat positions in the trenches. This is just training, but these fighters have already seen the front lines in combat. Somebody's abandoned house in a village near Bakhmut became their second home, says 40-year-old Vasil, who won't give his last name for security reasons. He was a music teacher in the Lviv region before volunteering for Ukraine's armed forces in August 2022. He gets letters and drawings from his students.
Just yesterday, I received a package with drawings and dumplings that my students made for me. Often in their letters, they ask when I will return. Well, it's not up to me. I will return when the war is over.
One of Vasil's comrades is 39-year-old Artem from Chernihiv. Artem used to run an IT business. In May of last year, he went to the front lines as a volunteer. Since then, near constant shelling has been his daily companion, but he's shaken every time one of his comrades gets hit.
It can happen at any moment. Recently, we suffered the loss of some of our best guys.
Oleg, a 29-year-old farmer from the Lviv region, feels the same way. He recalls not believing Russia's invasion was actually happening at first.
I am a pacifist by belief. Even when there was already information that the war started, I said, what kind of war could start when it is time to plant seeds soon?
Andriy, another farmer before the war, joined as a volunteer fighter in March 2022. He was wounded by shrapnel earlier this year, but is now back on the front lines.
I want to protect us and throw the enemy back behind the border, so our children and grandchildren would not know what it feels like to lose a normal, peaceful life we all had before.
To all of these men, the main dream is to win the war and come back to their families.
The main thing that keeps us going is probably the support of loved ones, friends, and the whole civilized world. We hear that weapons are coming and feel the support from the world expressed either in posts on Twitter or in donations and prayers.
Anna Kostyuchenko for VOA News, Donetsk region, Ukraine.
The U.S. Justice Department files an appeal challenging a Texas judge's order halting a long-standing regulatory approval of the abortion bill Mifepristone. The DOJ said it strongly disagrees with the decision of the Texas District Court, adding it will continue to defend the Food and Drug Administration's judgment that the pill is safe. The Texas judge revoked the two-decade-old approval of the abortion pill. But just an hour later, another federal judge, this time in Washington state, issued a competing injunction saying it must remain in the market for at least 12 Democratic-led states. Because of the competing court orders, the issue will likely escalate to the U.S. Supreme Court. This is the most significant abortion-related rulings in the U.S. since the Supreme Court overturned Roe v. Wade last year, which held a federal constitution right to an abortion. U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris called this dangerous.
There is no question that the president and I are going to stand with the women of America and do everything we can to ensure that women have the ability to make decisions about their health care, their reproductive health care, in a manner that is what they need, and they decide that, not their government.
U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris rallies for gun safety in Tennessee following the expulsion of Democratic Party lawmakers for participating in gun control protests. On Thursday, the Republican-controlled Tennessee House of Representatives voted to expel black lawmakers Justin Pearson and Justin Jones, who is also a Filipino-American. But the resolution to remove a third Democratic member, who stood with them during the protests on the House floor, Gloria Johnson, a white woman, came up one vote short. Harris said the lawmakers understood the importance of standing up and hearing the pleas and demands of the people.
A democracy says you don't silence the people. You do not stifle the people. You don't turn off their microphones when they are speaking about the importance of life and liberty. That is not what a democracy does. To act instead of the cowardice to not allow debate and to not allow a discussion on the merits of what is at stake.
President Joe Biden also met with the three lawmakers via video conferencing, thanking them for their courage in the face of a blatant disregard of the nation's democratic values. He also decried the expulsion, saying they were shocking, undemocratic, and without precedent.